Whole Story Quest Audiobooks presents Murder in Mink by Evelyn James, narrated by Helen Vine. Chapter 1. Clara had come to the conclusion that cars were a disagreeable way to travel, especially when they were open-topped and forced one to cling to one's hat. She also preferred to keep her eyes closed in case anything wandered into the road. A couple of miles back, there had been an ambling farm labourer who had incurred the wrath of the driver of the car she was currently in, for having the audacity to walk along the road. The rudeness of it all had stunned Clara, but it seemed this was the way all car people drove and treated everyone else on the roads. She had to wonder how an inanimate vehicle could seem to bring out the worst in everyone. Her brother, Tommy, sat beside the driver, taking in every gear change and fast-turning corner with the keen eye of the would-be car owner. Tommy had been left crippled by the war. But if only he had use of his legs, the things he would do. He'd love a car, Clara mused. If only he would go see that damn doctor who said he might be able to help. They turned a corner sharply and headed out of country lanes into a village. The driver, not a day over 18, Clara was certain, honked his horn loudly as though everyone needed to know he was there. A few people moved aside, while others gave him an evil glare. Clara was trying to remember his name. Jimmy or Timmy, something with a Y ending anyway. He had met them at the station under instructions from his employers, the Campbells, Clara and Tommy's cousins, to escort them in the car to the Campbell country seat. Clara had feared as much. She had heard the Campbells were fond of modern things and would not be without at least two cars. She closed her eyes again as they zigzagged down a narrow pathway between two old cottage walls. It surely did not seem big enough for a car, but the driver, Jimmy Timmy, hardly dropped his speed. It had all been so much bother since the letter had arrived the week before last. Clara had not given the Campbell family a thought in years, except for the traditional exchange of Christmas cards. Her grandfather had had a sister called Rosalie, who married Josiah Campbell, heir to the thriving coal mining concern. Rosalie had moved up north with Josiah and had two sons, while her brother had been more conservative and had a solitary child, Clara's father. Around 1900, Josiah Campbell had sensed trouble looming in the coal industry and had sold his mine for a ludicrous sum of money. He had been lucky. Within years, the coal market had collapsed. The war brought further calamity. Prices fell. Workers had to be laid off. And instead of a golden goose, the average coal mine was now considered a white elephant. Josiah Campbell never looked back. He invested his money, doubled it, then tripled it. There was talk of shady deals during the war, but nothing proven. When Josiah died in 1918, safe in the knowledge all his grandchildren, of which he had three, had survived the war, he was a millionaire many times over, and his estate was tidily divided between his sons. Now, 2 years on, there was a wedding due. The eldest grandchild, Andrew, was to be married on Saturday, and the occasion called for all branches of the family to be gathered, even distant cousins. Needless to say, Clara was a little anxious. Hogarth Campbell was the younger of Josiah's sons. He had kept in touch with Clara's father because they had once spent a summer together as boys. When Clara's parents had died, there had been a gushing letter from Hogarth, bereft forever at the loss. She supposed the last time she had seen him and his wife, Gloriana, was at her parents' funeral. Then there were the children, Andrew, Penelope, Peg, and Susan. Clara had a vague memory of them hovering at the back of the funeral procession. Andrew still in uniform, home on leave. Peg and Susan dressed in matching black outfits, looking little more than schoolgirls. They must be 18 and 20 now. Clara wondered if she would recognize them. The car swept through a pair of stone gates, ornamented with roaring lions, and the driver pumped the accelerator and churned up gravel as they zoomed up the drive. Clara allowed herself a peek at the surroundings. Tall, ornamental pine trees were dotted on either side of the lawn. There were chairs arranged beneath them, and at one corner, a croquet game had been laid out and then abandoned. The birds were singing in the treetops, but Clara noted there were no flower beds, which disappointed her. April had turned into May, and this was the season when many flowers found their form. It seemed strange such a grand garden was bereft of them. The house loomed up in neoclassical style. The driver pulled them sharply around the curve of the drive, level with the front door. Clara hopped out before he had pulled on the handbrake. She wasn't convinced he wouldn't start off again at any moment. A butler came down the front steps to greet her.
Miss Fitzgerald?
Yes. The butler raised a hand and two lads appeared to take the luggage from the car. My brother needs assistance. The butler gave a knowing smile and personally went around the car, retrieved Tommy's wheelchair and helped the young man into it.
Thanks, old boy,
Tommy grunted as he was negotiated into his chair.
My pleasure, sir. May I ask you to both come through? I have been asked to bring you to the summer room where the family is awaiting your arrival.
Clara felt her nerves redouble. She was not one for worrying about appearances normally, but she had the strangest desire to make a good impression on her cousins. She automatically patted her hat and straightened out her skirt. She readjusted the waist, which had ridden up from its fashionable position on her hips, and almost gave away that she had a figure. The problem was she wasn't convinced it was enough.
This way, please.
The butler politely coughed, halfway through dragging Tommy's chair up the steps. Jimmy Timmy, the driver, was rolling away in the car. There was no escape now. Clara braced herself and went to meet her long misplaced cousins. Chapter 2.
Tommy, you look so well.
Gloriana Campbell swept across the carpet in extravagant high heels and a dress Clara had recently seen in an advertisement for Harrods. She was not a day under 40, but she was the second wife, and that gave her an excuse to wear dresses that would have looked more fitting on her stepdaughters. She approached with arms theatrically wide and embraced Tommy with faux sentiment, kissing his forehead and leaving a blotch of lipstick.
Oh, Clara, you look so nice. The longer bob suits you.
Clara was equally embraced and treated to kisses on both cheeks. Gloriana's eyes gleamed a little too brightly.
I am so delighted you could make it. I hate to think how long it has been since we last saw you. I said to Hogarth we must not leave it so long again. Drinks?
Just a gin and tonic. Light on the gin, Clara said.
Oh, make it a cocktail, Gloriana beamed. Peg mixes the most blended ones. Peg, what is that new one you brought back from America last year? The Mississippi? The New York?
The Boston Belle. Peg had been languidly propped against the fireplace at the far side of the room. Now she stood and came towards her stepmother. Clara had to look at her twice. For certain, the schoolgirl was gone. For a start, Peg was dressed in trousers, and her hair was cropped so short it barely touched the lobes of her ears. She was oddly androgynous in her get-up. There was not an ounce of femininity from the way she stood to the flat shoes on her feet. Yet also she was not precisely masculine.
I'll mix it, Peg offered, flashing a smile at Clara and Tommy. Glory never gets the quantities right.
I thought our American friends had banned alcohol, Tommy remarked.
That they did. Prohibition began in January. I was there last October through December and missed the horrors of it all. I feel sorry for all those poor drunks. What will they do now? Peg was grinning wickedly.
I don't suppose you've seen Peg since she was a girl.
Gloriana gave a minor grimace, which might have been accidental. Clara risked a glance at Tommy, who, of all of them, seemed unflustered by Peg's appearance.
I say, Peg, are you one of those modern women who can't stand men?
He asked with such simplicity that even Clara was convinced it was an unconscious faux pas. Gloriana tensed, the lines of her dress suddenly becoming straighter. Peg, however, laughed loudly.
Don't be a fool, Tommy. I can stand men as long as they don't expect me to marry them.
She offered him a tumbler of clear liquid.
What about you?
Pretty much the same, Tommy grinned.
The tension in the situation diffused, as it seemed clear no one was taking offence. In fact, Clara had the distinct impression that Tommy had already developed a liking for Peg.
So you've been to America?
Only briefly. I didn't like it. Too many gangsters running around willy-nilly with the law taking no notice. They do know how to make a cocktail, though.
The gangsters?
Americans. Clara took a cautious sip of her drink. It was quite sweet, with a bitter aftertaste. Whatever alcohol was in it was cleverly masked, meaning it was probably hideously intoxicating.
Hogarth? Are you coming to say hello, Hogarth?
Gloriana was motioning to a large man to her right, who had been standing in the background until the calamity over Peg had been dealt with. Now he came forward, all joviality and good humour.
Darling Clara, look at you. Why, I remember you as that wee thing that pushed a dolly in a pram and refused to eat her carrots. Now you're all grown.
Hogarth was overweight, the sort of overweight that worries doctors and has them prescribing liquid diets and exercise. He was capacious, with a flurried face and a slight hint of sweat brought on by hauling his massive girth about. But he was friendly and appealing. He embraced Clara, and she smelt only soap and cologne. His eyes were merry, and he seemed genuinely delighted by her presence.
Your father would be so proud.
He held her at arm's length to see her better, and a tear dotted the corner of his eye.
Poor Gregory.
Hogarth, don't upset yourself. This is a happy occasion.
Gloriana patted his arm warmly.
You remember Andrew and Susan, don't you, Clara?
Almost eclipsed by Hogarth were his two final children. Andrew was tall and lean, complete opposite to his obese father. He also had a slightly haughty air and refrained from smiling as he shook Clara's hand. For a prospective bridegroom, he looked rather underwhelmed. Susan was bubbly and much like her father. She clasped Clara's hand and kept saying how delighted she was by, well, everything. The wedding, them coming, the parties, the food, the dresses, just everything. Clara suspected too long a time in her company could make you feel quite dizzy. With all the room announced, Gloriana returned to the practicalities of hostess.
Now, you will want to go to your rooms and freshen up for dinner. We eat at 7, but cocktails at 6. We are expecting Uncle Eustace tonight. Do you remember him?
Clara could not bring to mind the older Campbell brother. She didn't think he had come to her parents' funeral.
Never mind, you'll meet him soon enough. We are rather informal for dinner. Oh, silly me, and dear Laura will be there. That's the bride-to-be.
Clara and Tommy were shown to their rooms, on the ground floor for Tommy's convenience, feeling a bit dazed by the whole experience of meeting the Campbells. Peg did the honours of showing them the way, pushing Tommy as though she had known him forever.
What do you make of us then? She asked.
Clara glanced up.
Beg pardon? Well, you're a female detective, aren't you? Jolly good show, by the way. So you must look at that lot back there and have some thoughts.
Clara was not about to admit anything. Tommy was more forthcoming.
Clara plays her cards close to her chest. But you're thinking something, I take it, Peg?
I'm thinking a lot. But I think it is because I've been in America so long. You see, over there you have to watch your step so much because you never know who the bad guy is. But there is always this unspoken tension and, well, I don't know. It seems to me that when I came home there was just the same feeling here.
It's probably just the wedding, Clara replied. Everyone gets nervous about these things.
Yes, well, you haven't been here long yet. Give it a while and you'll see what I mean.
Peg halted them before their rooms.
Something's not right among them. Maybe someone's contemplating murder.
Peg roared with laughter. Clara failed to see the amusement. Over the last few months, she had been embroiled in 2 murder cases, 1 recent, 1 historic, and there had been nothing funny about them.
Well, I'll see you tonight. Ta-ra!
Peg waved them off and left them to discover their rooms. Clara pushed Tommy into his.
I hope it's not true, that thing they say about policemen never having a holiday because their work always follows them, Tommy mused.
Clara looked at him curiously.
Why?
Because it might be the same for private detectives.
Oh, don't be silly, Clara rolled her eyes. We are at a wedding. What could be further from thoughts of murder?
We only have to last the weekend and then we can be back home.
Yes, you're right.
Tommy shook off his sudden gloom.
Peg's a right one, isn't she?
I suspect she likes to shock people.
I don't doubt it. At least she is a bit lively.
Tommy surveyed his apartments. Ever wonder what it would have been like if our grandfather had been the one with the fortune? Clara glanced at the green curtains and the hint in the air of fresh paint.
I try not to.
Life is far more complicated with money.
Chapter 3
Laura Pettibone had a little too much money and not quite enough common sense. She arrived at dinner dressed in a sequined slip of a dress that dripped down in folds across her unnaturally flat chest. Her pretty blonde hair was bobbed with a kiss curl teased out onto her forehead. She spun to show off her dress at Hogarth's request, making the old man roar with laughter and comment on what the world was coming to. Bubbly Susan greeted Laura like a long-lost sister. She could not hope to emulate her sparkle. She was far too homely, but she had done her best in green velvet and pearls. Laura giggled and shook hands with everyone until she reached her fiancé, who greeted her with a delicate kiss on the cheek. It was also the first time in the entire evening he had bothered to smile. Clara observed Laura at a safe distance. Her dazzle was slightly overwhelming, and wondered what had attracted this unlikely pair to each other. Andrew had to be a decade older than his bride, and, at least from Clara's perspective, as well matched to Laura as a mouse to a cat. But when Laura appeared, something within him changed. His shoulders relaxed, his manner loosened. He became almost human. "What do you make of her?" Peg appeared with Tommy in tow. She had not left his side all evening, as if Tommy was some defense at the uncontained femininity all around them. Even Gloriana had donned mascara. "She wasn't what I expected," Clara admitted. "All sparkle, no substance," Peg said bluntly. "Does that matter?" Tommy grinned at them. Peg shared a look with Clara. "Typical male." "I know. Wait until the first crisis, and then where will all the glitter get you?" Peg shook her head. "I despair at the female race sometimes." "There is room enough in this world for the sparklers and us dullards, Peg," Clara smiled. "You wait until you've talked with her for a bit." Peg went to make herself another cocktail. "You have a new friend," Clara smirked at Tommy as soon as the coast was clear. "Peg's a good sort of chap to have around. You know, she has a racing car."
"Really?"
"Yes, up at Brooklyn's racing track. Andrew has one too. By the way, she won't admit it, but she is woefully jealous of all this wedding lark." That surprised Clara. "I didn't think that would matter to her." "Apparently it does. Peg's rather a complicated thing altogether, and anyway, beyond appearances, she is still a woman." They were ushered into dinner by the same butler who had greeted them on arrival. The early cocktails had gone to Clara's head, and she felt a little queer as she took her place beside Andrew, almost dead opposite his bride-to-be.
"I'm so glad you could come to the wedding, Clara," Laura gushed before they were barely seated. "When we first began planning the wedding, I half thought we would have no guests. Daddy does not have many relatives who are alive or anything less than positively ancient, and he doesn't have any friends. I'm relying on Andrew to fill up the church with guests."
"Who is your father?" Clara asked politely, relieved to see the soup was a light one served in small bowls. She was remembering why she rarely drank alcohol.
"Daddy owns the new rubber factory. Well, he did other stuff before, but he has been in rubber since 1918. He makes tyres. That's how I got to know Andrew. Daddy shows off his tyres at Brooklyn's."
"And your mother?" Clara risked a small sip of soup.
"Ran off with a travelling salesman when I was a child, or so Daddy says. She never writes."
The bluntness of the comment caused Clara a moment of hesitation. Laura seemed completely unperturbed by the effect of her honesty. She didn't even seem to realise how unusual it was to speak so openly.
"Daddy spoils me rotten because she left. He is really going to miss me when I leave with Andrew. I've promised him we will visit often, or I just don't think he would cope."
Through this announcement, Andrew had been mute, working steadily through his soup. Now he glanced up. "He'll be perfectly all right, Laura. He has the factory to keep him busy."
"But we will visit?"
"Occasionally. Christmas and such." Laura seemed to deflate slightly. For a while, she toyed with her soup and conversation evaporated, so Clara could overhear what was going on down the far end of the table.
"Penelope, dearest, you will wear a dress on Saturday and a pretty hat," Gloriana was saying. "Bloody nonsense. What's a wedding got to do with me wearing a dress? I'm not the bride."
"Watch your language, young lady."
That was Hogarth rumbling up from his soup.
"You'll do as your mother says."
"Please do not refer to Glory as my mother."
Peg sounded exasperated rather than angry.
"She is as good as. Besides, Saturday is about your brother, not you.
The angry conversation died down just as Laura seemed to revive herself.
Peg said you are a female detective, Clara. Is that true?
I am, yes. Clara put down her spoon, her soup virtually untouched.
Investigating crimes, like in the American novels?
Sometimes. Also, I trace missing cats, long-lost relatives, and unravel all manner of other mundane problems. Last week, a lady hired me to trace a knitting pattern she wanted.
Sounds rather dull.
Andrew butted in, and Clara sensed a sneer in his tone.
Only bits of it. I like helping people, and some of us don't have rich fathers.
As she said it, Clara could have kicked herself. She bit her tongue in remorse. Her temper so often was her undoing, especially when people insulted her work.
I'm sure it really is interesting.
Laura moved in as peacemaker.
Have you ever had to find a murderer?
Yes, twice.
See? Now that is exciting.
There was a sudden hammering at the door. All the guests looked up. The sound had apparently come from the entrance hall, and within a moment they could hear the front door being opened and someone entering.
Is that?
Gloriana went pale.
I thought he agreed not to come until after dinner.
You know what Eustace is like with timings. Anyway, he had to turn up eventually,
Hogarth placated. Clara cast a curious eye about the table, hoping someone would offer to explain the sudden tension that had fallen over them all. Her eyes briefly met Peg's, but if there had been any thought of speaking, it was crushed when the dining room doors burst open and a giant of a man stalked in. Uncle Eustace was close to 7 foot in height and favoured Hogarth's dimensions, though not on the same scale. He was also hot-tempered and prone to drinking too much. That was the best Clara could remember from rare comments she had picked up at home. He eyed the room with the look of an enraged madman.
Started without me?
Eustace, what a surprise!
Gloriana rose from her seat and fluttered a hand at Hogarth to grab another chair.
I wasn't expecting you until 9 o'clock.
I know you weren't. That's why I came early. I knew you would eat without me. What is it, Gloriana? Ashamed of me? Don't want me sitting in at your nice dinner and perhaps saying something embarrassing?
Gloriana was flushing vivid red. She fanned herself awkwardly with one hand and gave a tight smile to the collected guests.
Nonsense, Eustace. I was thinking of the train timetables, that's all.
You never could lie, Gloriana.
Eustace lumbered into the room. As he passed Clara, she caught the distinct whiff of beer.
I don't really care, you know. I'm used to it. Father was always embarrassed by me too. Perhaps if you didn't turn up smelling like a brewery.
Hogarth grumbled, herding his brother to a chair he had hastily placed between himself and his wife.
I had a quick drink before catching the train.
Eustace fell into the chair with an ominous creak of wood.
I hate waiting around, so a beer or two passes the time.
Or five, Andrew grimaced at his uncle.
Andrew! Hogarth!
Gloriana cast a stern glance at her menfolk.
Eustace is a guest, and we will have none of that talk.
Good old Glory, always trying to keep things peaceable. They should have sent you over to France in the war. Saved us some lads if you could have calmed down the damn Huns.
Eustace gave a belly laugh that failed to be taken up by the table.
Soup, Eustace?
Gloriana was motioning to servants for extra cutlery.
If you don't mind, I'll skip to the real food.
Eustace gave the guests a theatrical wink before his eye fell on Peg.
Who's that fellow? Never seen him before.
That is Penelope, Hogarth said with barely concealed exasperation.
Thought Penelope was a girl's name.
It is. Clara caught Tommy's eye. He was semi-amused by the performance of Uncle Eustace, but it was apparent the family were not.
Now, where's the bride-to-be?
Eustace's eye roved up the table, briefly pausing on Clara, until Laura announced herself.
I'm the bride!
She giggled, offering out a hand which Eustace struggled to reach over the table.
Nice to meet you, Uncle Eustace. I'm Laura.
Well, you are a pip, aren't you?
Eustace's eyes had grown round.
How on earth did you catch her, Andrew?
Gloriana was trying to distract everyone with the arrival of the main course, but Eustace had honed in on Laura.
Quite remarkable. What do you want to go marrying old Grizzleguts for? You should have someone lively and fun.
Oh, but Andrew is fun.
Eustace burst into another of his giant-sized laughs.
Well, how do you like that?
Eustace, refrain yourself from insulting my children. Hogarth snapped.
But look at her, man. She's one of them flappers, all laughter and knees. She isn't the type for Andrew.
I think I can determine my type for myself, thank you. Andrew responded haughtily, making himself appear every bit the stern boor his uncle was accusing him of being.
If you say so, Andrew. I'm not here to cause a stir.
Eustace accepted a plate of duck and orange sauce, and for a moment peace descended on the troubled table. Clara picked at her duck. The effects of the cocktail were wearing off with the addition of food, but her mind was too distracted to have sufficient time to restore her appetite. Eustace was nothing like his brother Hogarth. He was boorish, blunt, and rude. His brother played the amiable, considerate host, while Eustace seemed determined to upset everyone around him. Clara had no knowledge if he had always been this way or whether family tensions had made him into this man of insults. Knowing what large families were like, there was usually always something brewing just beneath the surface. Was Eustace the black sheep because he couldn't hold his tongue, or had resentment made him that way? She snuck a look down the table. Eustace was absorbed in sopping up sauce with potatoes. Gloriana looked disgusted by the performance and was merely toying with her food. Hogarth was making a determined effort to ignore his brother. Clara returned to her duck, and Laura caught her attention.
Is he always like this?
Clara gave a shrug. Andrew had overheard. Always, he sneered. That's why, even though Eustace is the oldest, father inherited the estate from grandfather. Eustace fritters his money away in London. Laura's eyes widened, and she looked on Eustace with a new understanding, but it was not necessarily a look of revulsion. Clara thought she seemed rather fascinated with him. It occurred to Clara that she too wondered what Laura could see in her future husband, though she would never voice such thoughts aloud like Eustace. Dinner ended with a selection of ices and coffee. Almost as soon as he could, Andrew deserted the gathering, claiming he was going to smoke on the terrace. Laura watched him leave with a strangely fretful look. Gloriana suggested the ladies retire to the drawing room. Peg started to protest, but a look from her stepmother silenced her. Tonight was not the time for petty quarrels. Clara retreated with Laura, managing to catch Tommy's disgruntled look as he was left virtually alone with the overweight and now heavily sweating Eustace.
What's up with you then?
She heard Eustace bellowing at Tommy as the ladies hastened to the drawing room. Once inside, Gloriana took a cigarette from a box on the mantel and lit it with impatience.
Make us cocktails, Peg. Something strong, she pleaded.
Not for me, Clara quickly added. I can only take my cocktails in small doses.
By the dickens, that was awful.
Gloriana paced before the fireplace, puffing on the cigarette with unconscious obsession.
What possessed him to come early?
He wanted to cause trouble. Peg walked over with a tray of drinks. You know what he's like.
I can't stand him.
Gloriana took a glass and almost poured the contents down her throat.
How can that man be related to Hogarth?
Quite easily, Peg said, taking her own cocktail. Don't take him to heart, Glory.
Was he always like this? Or is it me? Does he resent me?
Uncle Eustace was always queer. I don't remember exactly when he stopped being so welcome at the house, but it was when I was still a girl.
He didn't upset you, Laura, did he?
Susan reached out a hand to grip her friend's wrist.
Don't be silly, Laura grinned at them all. I found it all rather interesting. Dinner parties can be so dull. Oh, except yours, Gloriana.
Gloriana waved off the unintentional insult. So, Clara decided it was her turn for questions. What is Eustace's story?
He is a drunken wastrel,
Gloriana said bluntly. He doesn't get on with father. Never has, from what I understand, Peg added. The pair of them are virtually enemies, from what I make out. Eustace keeps his distance, which is just as well. We see him maybe at Christmas or at gatherings like this, but otherwise he keeps at his club in the city.
Does he resent that, you know, being exiled from his family home?
If he does, he can hardly complain. It's his own fault. Peg shrugged her shoulders. I think there was a huge rift between him and Grandfather. The only reason he wasn't disinherited is because Father stood up for him. Eustace should be grateful. People don't always think that way, Clara observed. Well, he drives me to distraction, Gloriana stubbed out her cigarette. I'll just be glad to get rid of him after the wedding. I shan't be asking him to stay on any longer. I try to be nice, and you see how he throws it back at poor Hogarth. Andrew is certainly blistering about it, Laura said, with almost a hint of mischief. Oh, Andrew understands his uncle, Peg reassured them all. He'll get over it. I don't know if I ever will. Gloriana raided the mantel box for another cigarette. I'll kill him if he ruins Andrew and Laura's wedding. Clara wished people wouldn't say such things in her presence. They had a nasty way of etching themselves onto her brain. Chapter 4. Clara accepted the invitation more out of curiosity than anything else. Why, after all, was Laura Pettibone asking her to call round the day before her wedding? She decided not to mention the invite to any of the Campbell family and headed across the family estate, aiming for the rough direction of the village where Laura lived. It was a fine day and spring was reassuringly in the air. Soon it would be summer, and the welcome warmth would revive everyone after the damp and cold of winter. Clara ambled down the path, enjoying the freedom of a quiet stroll away from the tensions of the house. What to make of it all? Would Eustace really upset the wedding? No, he didn't seem to be that insensitive. Just inclined to make his presence known by being as rude and aggressive as possible. Hogarth would surely keep him in check.
Good morning.
Clara woke from her thoughts to see the local vicar tipping his hat to her. She smiled back. Their paths crossed as he headed past her towards the church on the top of the hill. She supposed she would be seeing more of him tomorrow. The lane wound into the village, taking Clara past a small sweet shop and a pharmacy with big, elongated glass jars of blue liquid in the window. The post office loomed and she nipped inside for directions to Laura's house. Within moments, she was back on her way, taking a right turn past the pub and finding herself suddenly approaching a grand grey building. It was not the lavish scale of the Campbell residence, but nor was it humble. The front door was set beneath a pillared portico and a string of windows gazed out onto the front drive. A delivery man was just leaving as Clara entered the gate, and the house had a bustling feel to it, as though it was alive and busy in its own right. She took two steps to the front door and rang the bell. A maid showed her to Laura's sitting room upstairs. The bride-to-be was reclining on a white sofa in a silk dressing gown, her hair heaped in bouncy curls about her shoulders. She cast aside a movie magazine as Clara entered and stretched out her arms.
Is it 11 o'clock already?
She asked languidly. A little after. Laura swept off the sofa gracefully and enfolded Clara in her arms. For Clara, always rather reserved with affection, the sudden embrace of a virtual stranger caught her off guard.
I'm so glad you could come. Would you like to see my wedding dress?
Laura grabbed her guest's arm and hauled her into the bedroom next door. The bedroom was decorated in an assortment of cream and white colours, the effect almost blinding. In another home, it would have seemed barren or even bleak, but it was offset by the piles of gowns in rainbow colours cast everywhere. Shoes were haphazardly discarded on the carpet, and scarves and wraps hung off the bedstead in a row. Clara found the room strangely claustrophobic, despite its brightness, and wondered how anyone could sleep in it.
This is it.
Laura pulled out a white dress that, in contrast to the rest of the clothes in the room, was neatly contained on a hanger. It was just the sort of dress Clara had imagined Laura in. Straight cut, low-waisted, with a plain sash cutting across the hips and the skirt in straight pleats. It would hang just above the ankle, exposing a pair of white calfskin shoes with a thick heel and a ribbon to tie them rather than laces.
This is the veil.
Laura pulled a tight hat onto her head, almost masking her short bob, and pulled the long and vast veil about her. Clara came forward and helped her arrange it.
It is very pretty. Do you think so?
Certainly, and it will suit you down to a T.
I think it's the bee's knees.
Laura removed the veil and put away the dress. Clara wondered if this was all she had been summoned for, to examine a dress and pass comment, or whether there was more motive behind her urgent invite. After all, if Laura wanted a mother substitute, Gloriana Campbell was by far the better choice.
I noticed your dress yesterday.
Laura had sat at her dressing table and was combing out her hair.
I thought it suited you well.
Clara hoped that was a compliment. Her dress had been made up by Annie, her maid, following a pattern in a woman's magazine. She couldn't pretend it had the grandeur of a designer dress, but she did think it had a certain flair to it.
Do you wear lipstick?
Laura asked. Sometimes. Clara produced a round case from her bag and showed its crimson contents.
But not mascara? You should. It would bring out your eyes. Here, I'll show you.
Clara was sat on another chair at the table, and Laura produced a box of black mascara and a fine brush.
If you think it too expensive to buy, have your cook make it from Vaseline and coal dust. It works just as well. I have used that in emergencies.
Clara consented to having her eyes made up. She was still certain there was an ulterior motive to her invitation, and perhaps being cooperative would draw it out. Besides, having her eyes done enabled her to be silent while Laura chatted away.
I've worn mascara since last year. Daddy thought it ghastly at first, but he has gotten used to it. Andrew never said anything. I'm not sure he noticed.
There was a hesitation that Clara felt certain was meaningful, even if she was currently looking up at the ceiling to enable Laura to paint under her eyes.
Do you have a boyfriend, Clara?
Not really.
It isn't easy these days. I know a lot of my friends complain that there are so few young men about. I suppose it was that awful war. I'm sure several of my friends will never have the chance to get married, and they know it too. Just look at Peg. She has clearly given up. Still, I don't blame her for wanting to dress like a man. They still have it best, don't they?
But you were able to find a man to marry?
Oh, yes. I mean, when Andrew asked me, I just, well, jumped at it. I might not get another chance, and I don't want to end up an old maid.
Clara wondered if this was the key to her sudden summons. How long had you been going with Andrew before he proposed?
I hadn't. Laura paused. I had hardly noticed him, to be honest. But then he asked me to marry him, just like that. It was 1919, and he was looking all dashing in his uniform, and I thought, why not? Up till then, everything had seemed so hopeless.
Didn't it worry you that you barely knew him? Laura put down the mascara.
Suppose it did. Just suppose.
Well? Laura wiped the mascara brush on a tissue.
What do you think?
She said, referring to the makeup. Clara examined her reflection. To her surprise, she liked the way the makeup had made her eyes seem bigger and wider.
Not bad. Add some lipstick and it will be perfect.
Laura was rearranging the table.
Would you marry a man you hardly knew because you were desperate not to be alone?
No. Clara was blunt, but she knew Laura was craving her honesty.
Not at all.
Loneliness does not frighten me as much as the idea of spending my life with a stranger. Are you having second thoughts, Laura?
Oh, no!
Laura rapidly stood up and walked across the room.
At least, not big doubts.
I think everyone worries about getting married, Clara said. Now you have got to know Andrew. Do you like him?
Oh, Clara, I love him!
The outburst was so impassioned, Clara was in no doubt it was the truth.
But? What do you make of Andrew?
I don't really know him.
But you are a detective, Gloriana told me, and I was so excited to think my husband's cousin is a female detective. Even Peg was impressed.
That doesn't mean I can judge a person on sight. You are the person best set to know Andrew through and through.
That's the problem. I don't really know him. Not like that. I think he masks so much of himself from me.
Laura sank onto the bed.
Sometimes I don't understand him at all. I'm not scared of him or anything like that. I just can't quite get my head around who he is. I think he has secrets.
Most people do.
I want to know everything about him, yet he won't let me in, and some people...
Laura quirked her lips and stared into the distance.
What was your first impression of him, honestly?
Honestly?
Absolutely.
Clara decided this was dangerous territory and tread carefully. Honesty had a low tolerance threshold.
I think Andrew is clever, commanding, very much built in a military mould. A little reserved, perhaps, shy of his emotions. I doubt he tolerates fools graciously, but I saw no reason to consider him cruel about it. I suspect, like many men who served in the war, he aches inside a lot for a host of reasons neither of us can truly understand.
Yes. Yes, that is Andrew. See? I knew you were clever enough to understand him all at once.
Laura clapped her hands together excitedly.
And do you think he'll make a good husband?
That really was dangerous territory. Most men do, with a little time. Has someone said otherwise? Laura seemed to sag.
Susan. Susan seems to think I'm rushing in.
Andrew's sister?
Yes. She says I have hardly had a chance to know him and to know if I want to be a wife. She says I'm setting myself up for disappointment. But Susan isn't me. Susan wants to have a life, a career. She is good at things like typing and learning facts. I'm not good at anything, except, well, getting dressed up.
Laura wafted a hand at a heap of clothes.
I'm sure Susan says it's out of my best interests, but it rankles so.
I can imagine. Look, this is very much your decision. Only you can say for certain how you feel about Andrew and marriage. If you want to marry him and are happy to accept all that married life entails, then no one should try and dissuade you. Susan has her own view on life, but that doesn't mean she knows what is right for you. Laura perked up.
You really are a wise bean. Have you considered marriage, Clara?
Clara had, but she kept those ideas tucked in a dark corner of her mind, since marriage seemed a far-off hope.
A little. But, you know, not everyone can get married. Sometimes there isn't the right person out there for them. Oh, I know, which is why I feel so lucky finding Andrew. I sometimes wonder if Susan is jealous. She's never had a young man of her own, and Peg lost hers during the war.
Really?
Didn't you know? They were engaged and everything. It was 1918, I think. That's when she began dressing like a man.
I'm sorry to hear that. So many people lost loved ones that way.
Well, I was very lucky that Andrew came back in one piece.
Laura picked up a turquoise bangle and lazily spun it around her hand.
Was Tommy in the war?
Yes, that's how he lost the use of his legs.
That's a shame. I didn't get a chance to speak to him, but he seems nice. Does he like cars?
Laura was suddenly off her bed and rummaging through a drawer.
Here, I've been dying to find the right person for these. Brooklyn's has a race meet on Sunday, an informal thing, but there will be lots of drivers racing. Andrew is in it. We are postponing the honeymoon so he can race. Just think. I consider that very understanding of me.
Laura expected approval, and Clara quickly agreed.
Oh, yes, very understanding. Well, Andrew got these tickets, and golly if I know who to ask. But if Tommy would like to go, and you, of course, two tickets are yours.
I think Tommy would like that, but we weren't planning on staying beyond the wedding.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.